Hi, welcome to vlog number 74. This is the vlog where I talk about Quarterly Stories, which is my graphic novel that I hand write, hand letter, hand ink, and then hand to you. And you can hear my son in the background talking about colors and letters. That's because it's a Saturday and it's kind of midday, and I thought I'd try to get at least the beginning of my inks done. But anyhow, so Quarterly Stories is a very personal story to me. It's a story about faith and mental illness. And this is the vlog where I talk about the process and the progress of creating this graphic novel on top of being a full-time father, a full-time husband, and a full-time art director. So, so far the day is going pretty effectively. I am hoping to get... kind of hoping to get this panel, maybe another panel, and then get started on another art project that will be a little change of pace. It's going to be a painting project. And so that's kind of what I'm hoping to do today. But we'll see. We'll see how it goes. But anyhow, so last vlog, I guess, I actually thought it would be cool to kind of just do some real-time vlogs where instead of having sped up inking and stuff like that, where I would just actually go through this process in real time and just kind of talk about art and talk shop about comics and stuff like that. So I've been thinking more about my comic becoming kind of a reality because I'm getting further along. So this is page 48, but if I include the chapter break pages, which I don't online, I mean, I count those as separate things. I think I just call them chapter title page on my website, Quarterly Stories. But if I include those, I'm actually on page 48 plus 3 would be 51. And that's a lot closer to done than I realized. Like, that's a lot closer to getting to that 3-issue mark. Another thing I've been thinking about is the reality of floppies. And by floppy, that's just what I call a 32-page comic, like your standard, you know, saddle stitch comic that has two staples in it and, you know, would be 32 pages in length. So I was thinking about it, and to justify printing these as like saddle stitch books, it would be a high cost and a low return, in the sense that you know, it actually makes a lot more sense, especially considering my own consuming habits. Like, I don't tend to buy floppy comics that much anymore. I usually wait till the trade is out, and I think in a story like this that has difficulty catching a following, serializing online, I think that you're going to end up in kind of deep water if you try to market this kind of book as like a 32-page comic. So I still like the idea of floppies, and I've kind of designed this to be done in 32-page floppies, but I'm thinking maybe instead of reframing that to be 32-page chunks. You know, there's these little chapters which can vary in length depending on the theme. And then there will be, you know, 32-page chunks that are separated by, you know, cover designs. But inevitably, maybe these just end up being a series of 96-page graphic novels. So that's something I've been thinking about because, like I said, I feel like I'm getting a little bit closer to it. And by closer, I mean like, you know, like a year or so away. And actually what's interesting is that's not that far away. I mean, that's not in an unforeseen future. That's kind of more something that might be something I can start laying some groundwork for now. So that's something I'm thinking about with Quarterly Stories. I'm starting to think how I want to approach marketing it when it's out. How I want to try some new direct marketing tactics with individual retailers, And then also just starting to think about how am I going to sell this online? Am I going to make digital copies available? I've realized, yes, I definitely am going to want to make sure to sell ebooks of this as well. The dog is barking because he hears a neighbor's dog. And yeah, he's still going at it. So it's interesting to start to kind of think about these things. And I'm actually kind of excited because this doesn't feel like forced thinking. This is just like visualizing. And it's starting to feel a little bit like it did back in the day when I made Numb. Because, and that's for those of you who aren't familiar, like this is years ago. I mean, like back when there was this grant, but I did this little short comic called Numb that I got a Zarek grant for. And it was my first comic, and I kind of got into my last vlog. But what's interesting is, like, I think I had this strange idea that I needed to rely on publishers to make comics happen, or like somehow by having a publisher, it legitimizes what you're doing. And the more I've like gotten to know people in comics and thought about my own comic and the difficult marketing that lies ahead of it and all the legwork I'd have to do to kind of get this thing building and get a following. The kind of marketing I'd have to do to get like a following or anything really going for this. I'm starting to think that it might actually be better to self-publish this. And so in that case, like there's all sorts of options and interesting things that I'm starting to think about. And I'm also realizing that having like a 96-page book, while that won't be the full story, you know, that would be like the first of like many graphic novels, at least that would be able to substantiate and justify the expense of like booths at conventions, because then the return compared to the cost is going to be a little higher and there's a better chance of making back table, especially considering that I have this ambitious desire when it comes to finishing this thing to try something new. Because prior to this, my convention experience, and this is a while ago, it's been a long time since I've done conventions. But when I did do conventions, the way I would make money and make back table was mostly by selling prints and postcard packs. And a lot of it was by selling stuff I had done for Threadless as prints. And a lot of that is like pop cultural, silly stuff, and isn't as targeted. Now, I did sell quite a bit of my own comics that way. But my booths were never really like centered around anything except joshuakemble.com, which was my illustration business. And I mean, it made sense when I was freelance and I was completely reliant on that illustration business. Like, if today I were to find out that, you know, somehow the job I'm working at currently didn't work out, I would have to rely on that income again. Like the freelance illustration business. And so like that's not a bad model to kind of do some branding, going to like conventions. But for me right now, I'm not interested in branding myself. I'm interested in branding this comic Quarterly Stories. And so I've started to like think about the fact that like I'm visualizing when I have a booth at conventions, what do I want it to be? And I've realized that I really want my booth to be something that's completely geared around this comic, with nothing in at the booth that's not related directly to this property, because that's the reason I'm going. I'm not going to get work as an illustrator. I'll be going to those things to promote this book and give it the best shot at succeeding that I possibly can give it. And so that's going to be kind of the goal, is to promote the book and the website and then also sell some books and hopefully like, you know, prints and maybe t-shirts and pins and stuff like that, but everything would be related to the comic directly. So So yeah, so it also fills me with a little bit of nervousness. Just thinking about it makes me slightly nervous. And I'll explain why. I mean, it's like if you've done something before, like we've done, my wife and I have done comic conventions since we were together. And so like, it's really nothing new, the idea of conventioning, but the comics industry and the convention industry and a lot of things have changed, just like everything else, like things change. And it's been so long that there's a part of me that gets a little bit of nerves, like thinking about it. But then I have to remind myself that I've been out in the middle of a situation where I don't know what I'm doing before. I mean, that's kind of 80% of how you get into art in the first place. And so that also starts to quell my worries about that. Now, a lot of you guys might think like it's silly that I'm thinking ahead that much about what I plan to do with this comic and what my hopes are for it. But part of what I'm doing is thinking, forward thinking. And that's kind of part, like a good chunk of what my job is now as an art director is to think ahead. So it's my staff, a lot of my staff, their job is to be concerned about the immediate, about the quick deadline and whatever design is on their dock for the day. And my job as an art director is to kind of think big picture. Like, what's our company going to look like next year? What is our profit going to be at the end of the year? What could next year look like? What could we do to reformat our department so that we have better art and better output and it's better for my designers? And so like any decisions I make need to be good for the short term, but also, and even more so, have long-term returns, because that's, you know, I'm supposed to be being a big picture thinker as a manager. And at coming into that, I have an advantage because I've always kind of been a big picture thinker. When I got out of college, I wasn't really so much concerned with what I was going to be doing immediately out of college. I mean, that was, of course, a concern. But almost every decision I made was a gamble and an investment in a future career as an illustrator. At the time, that was my goal. And so almost every move I would make would be to try to advance that career somehow and to kind of visualize, like, what's it going to look like when I am a freelance illustrator? What kind of clients am I looking for to work for in 10 years or in 2 years or in 3 years? Like, where do I want to see my company grow? And that kind of thinking led to some really weird things. Like, because here's what happens when you set kind of long off goals. And I'll use this as an example. Like, when my wife and I decided to have a kid, we were sharing an apartment and in Long Beach, kind of like not a bad neighborhood, not a great neighborhood, but a little apartment. And it wasn't really a suitable environment to like raise a kid. And we could have raised our kid in there and been okay. But we actually started kind of talking about, hey, maybe it would be cool if we, because we knew people who lived in the Antelope Valley in California who had houses and who made it work under like relatively small incomes for California. Like, for those of you who aren't familiar with like California and what it costs to live here, it's like what a lot of the country would consider a large income isn't enough to live on in the Los Angeles area. And so the Antelope Valley is like this area where, you know, we noticed that like housing costs were crazy low, and a lot of people were paying for their house what, you know, people near us in the Los Angeles area were paying for an apartment. And so we just started randomly thinking about it. And then as time went on, that little like far off thought started becoming a reality. So when there were job opportunities, a job opportunity opened up in this area that fit my skill set, had, you know, a decent, you know, pay and was in a location where it would be possible to kind of live in this area We really jumped at it. And I probably wouldn't have jumped at it with such vigor and such interest had that not been like a long-term goal that at some point we might be able to have a house. So once again, we weren't really thinking about the short term so much as the long term with that decision. And so like we moved in with some family and we saved up and we were able to buy a house. And that is kind of like long-term thinking with action kind of as a result. Like I never really thought that we could have a house, but then we started daring to kind of dream it. Like what would that look like? Like how would we get there? What steps would we need to take to kind of be a family with a house? You know, like what steps would we need to take to save up the money? And so on. And I'm not saying that works for everybody. Like it's not like you can just say like I want to do this, so therefore it's going to happen. It's more like saying that that's kind of how things happen, at least for me in my life. That's how things have happened, and they don't always work out the way that I planned or anything like that. But it's just that starting to think about like future stuff, like really, I think not only like allows it to be a possibility, but it also allows it to be something that you can start to plan for and start thinking and asking really important questions, like you know, basic questions like, well, okay, so I know it sounds far off, but you know, like how could that happen? Like, could that happen? Could that like really be something we or I could do, you know? And like so what's exciting me about working on quarterly stories right now is I'm starting to have some of those thoughts. And I think they're kind of healthy thoughts. Like they're the thoughts that at least so far in my life, when I start having them, usually lead to some kind of movement, some kind of thing happening. And like I said, they haven't all worked out. Like I think I talked about this on my last vlog, but you know, like I had invested years in a graphic novel years ago that like pretty much by all accounts kind of failed, you know, and it failed pretty epically. Like, you know, it's a book that is sitting unpublished, and you know, I think that tends to be that's always a possibility. There's a possibility with this thing too, and I had really big plans for that. So it doesn't, like I said, it doesn't always work out. But my point is, by kind of daring to think about the future and daring to kind of start thinking about like with this, like what's it gonna look like when it's a finished book? And like even initially, like you know, modifying the plans based on those thoughts. Like you know, initially my goal with this was to have three floppy comics, and I'm already kind of altering that. And that's part of that's part of like a result of that kind of thinking, which is, you know, like thinking like, okay, so I want this thing to come out, and I want to get this in people's hands, and I want to get this in retailers' hands. Like I want it to be in stores, not like stores all over the country. Maybe long term that would be cool, but for now, just like local stores. Like I'd like to have this at some comic shops, and starting my thinking there and thinking about, okay, well, how could that happen? And asking that question led me to realizing like maybe floppies aren't the best way to get there, you know, to get the result. And also maybe floppies aren't the best thing for like what I would want to buy. So, anyhow, that's just something to kind of start thinking about, you know. While you're working on your projects, you know, like what does this look like? Whatever you're working on, like what are you envisioning this becoming? And a lot of you guys might be actually better at that than I am, you know. I think I might have a tendency to overthink this kind of thing. A lot of people, once they had a floppy's worth, might be running a Kickstarter right now and getting it out there. For me, that's not what I envisioned for this comic. And like I said, I don't want to do all the groundwork that I think it's going to take to really give this the best shot that it can have to succeed. I don't think it would be good to do the groundwork without a pretty substantial amount of the story out there to kind of back it up. Meaning, I think like a larger chunk of the story is going to back up its quality. Because this isn't like a serialized type of story. This is more going to be like a life's work kind of project that I'm taking on. And so because of that, like I really need to give people a good sample of it to give them a reason to be invested in it with me. And I really do kind of have faith in the fact that like I think that that those people exist. I think there are people who will be willing to invest in this. Maybe they're not like massive amounts of people, and you know, it's probably not going to be like Eisner level attention or anything on this, but I do have faith in the fact that like I think there are like a substantial amount of people who would really like this book, especially at scale. Like these pages look really cool sized down to what I'd like them to be sized at, like, because they're being drawn so large, they look really pretty stunning at a smaller size. So anyhow, like, that's what I've been thinking about today, and it was kind of fun. Like, I started talking to my wife about, you know, like, some game plans that we might put in place when this gets done, and we're thinking about possibly even attacking some of the marketing as a team, which is really exciting to me. My son is a toddler, and so he has these moments of just wonderful joy. Yeah, and so right now he's kind of unhappy because the dogs are sticking around near him like sharks, you know, waiting for food to drop. And so justifiably, he's finding it kind of annoying and telling them not to touch and mess with his food, so. But yeah, so like, I mean, you know, I'm excited about this YouTube channel. I know this particular one, vlog isn't all that exciting because there's a lot of toddler and a lot of noise in the background and stuff like that, but, so in a little bit, I'm thinking about heading to, like, Michael's or, like, we don't have a proper art store here in the Antelope Valley, which is kind of a bummer. But I'm thinking about heading to like Michael's or Walmart and or maybe Home Depot and just seeing if I can get some wood panels that are good to paint on. And then I'm hoping that like I still have, I should probably double check this after this vlog is done and after I've got like a little bit more of this panel done. But another thing I want to check is like, do I still have like gesso and paint, you know? And brushes and stuff, like are those still hanging out? I think I do in the garage, but I barely paint. You know, my wife does watercolors, and so she has the tools for that. But with this, I'd want it to be, this other little project, I'd want it to be like, you know, painted with paint that is opaque and not transparent. And so that would require gesso, and I would want it to be on wood panels. And it might be like a failed project as well, like this kind of thing. This one's just kind of a fun thing. Although I was thinking about doing a video of it and then maybe like offering the potential, like if anybody watching the video likes it, you know, they could like hit me up for a commission or something like that for like this style of portrait. Because they might be kind of fun to do, but I got to see how it goes on this first one to see if that's even some like a Pandora's box I want to open. But what's been exciting to me about like the YouTube community too is like just realizing like there's a community of people that want to support, you know, good artwork. And I feel like the more this channel builds with like subscriptions and that kind of thing, the more that like, you know, it gives this comic that I'm working on like more of a possibility to kind of like succeed. And that the thought that that might even happen is pretty exciting to me. You know, being that, like, you know, I already have kind of a career And I'm already pretty happy in my personal life because I have like a great family and stuff like that. But there's like this part of me that like still wants to have comics out there, and not just comics out there, but like people reading them. And so it's really exciting to me that like, like this channel's gaining a little bit of momentum, and that people are willing to kind of spend time and check it out. And also just starting to visualize the future, like I said, I think that's a really valuable tool that you can use as an artist to kind of start visualizing your career and visualizing what it looks like if you succeed. Because I think a lot of people don't even do that kind of thinking. Like they'll do negative thinking or they'll do no thinking. So it'll be like shoot down ideas like, well, that won't work because blah, blah, blah. That won't work because I couldn't do that because. And it's like a list of negatives. So that's one possibility. And actually, sometimes it's good to have like, friends in your life and people in your life who think that way because it'll help you stay centered and realistic with your goals, it's always good to run your ideas by someone who has that kind of mindset because they'll maybe find some problems with your idea. And then there are people who, are like, well, I want this, but, they don't really go past that. Like, well, I want this to be my future, but I don't think about it. Like I'm not going to think about the steps that would actually make that reality. And I think that if you want to be an artist or a freelance artist or an illustrator, you really have to start being able to visualize positively, like more than just ideas, more than just thoughts, but like realities of how you could get there. So like I want this client. How do you get to that client? Like how do you get your stuff to that client? How does your work gain momentum? How do you build a fan base that's going to make you important enough for that client to care? And wow, I just sneezed all over my page. I might have to edit that out. That's going to be funny, Econ. I still have a cold. That's something worth mentioning. But like thinking about those realistic questions about like how do you make that a reality? Like that's a really good question to ask yourself. Like if there's something you want, like how are you gonna get there? And then like that helps you kind of break down things by like reverse engineering them. Because like let's say you're, like me, and you want a book, and you want to finish a book. Well, what do you need to do to get there? Well, I mean, first you need content, and you probably need it to be good if you want it to sell, or you want people to be interested, and so on. Like, how do you get it good? Well, you probably have to refine your craft, and how do you refine your craft? And then, like, once you've refined your craft, how are you going to end up with this book? Well, you got to invest time. How do you invest time? Like, where are you going to budget and make that time? And so on, I think that ability to do that is going to be like a real make or break thing in your art career if you're an aspiring artist. At least for me, it has been. It's been a huge dividing line between myself and other artists as to why I've even gotten work. It's just you have to really want it, and you have to be able to ask yourself what you're gonna do realistically to get it. And here's the thing that makes that a little harder than negative thinking. Negative thinking will always get you a very comfortable, predictable result, which is like, or and no thinking as well. Both of those are gonna give you very predictable, very comfortable results, which is you're gonna end up exactly where you are. So like, if I were to say, be a person who was like, I really love comics, I want to make comics, I've always wanted to make a graphic novel, and it just stops there, then I have just completely defined my future. And it's not that hard to say where that future is going to go because, like, that's that. If that was the end of my ambition, then that's the end of your ambition. So it's not that hard to predict, like, where that's going to lead, you know? Because it's like, okay, well, that's that. Whereas if you give yourself the possibility and you try really hard and make time and you start reverse engineering and taking positive steps toward your goal, you do open up this really frightening possibility, which is a possibility of failure, and not just failure on like a short term, but like in the case of something like a graphic novel, failure that's really not going to be easy to take because you put a lot into it. And when you put a lot into something and it doesn't work out, it hurts a hell of a lot more than if you just thought about it and were just like, well, it didn't really work out, you know? But you're also opening the possibility of success. And I think it's important when you're thinking about like future stuff like that to also allow for success as a possibility. And not just that, but to like plan for success. Like, so if we do succeed at the goal, then like what does that become? How do you handle that? How do you deal with that? You know, and similarly, like I think that this is, I know it sounds like a long rant and stuff, but it's more like how do I kind of put it? I guess my point is that the thinking I've been doing today has excited me because I've gotten past one of my wilder goals, which was, you know, when we had our son, I took a long break from making art, for personal projects. I took a very long break. And I didn't even know, honestly, if I was going to get back to it. Like, I was just like, okay, well, I'm just going to kind of make my work my main thing and then my home my main thing. And then I had this weird thing happen, which was like the desire to make comics got really strong again. And so I was like, I had this kind of little daydream. And I went through this whole path where I was like, okay, well, what'll it look like if I get back into making comics? And I just kind of thought ahead a little bit. I was like, okay, well, if I want to make a graphic novel of the length and the interest, I need to start, A, just making good work. And to make good work, I'm going to need to make time. And to make time, I'm going to need to kind of find little windows because right now, I'm not willing to compromise, you know, family time. Like I need to keep family time on the dock. So how am I gonna make time to get this done? And initially a lot of this just felt like, well, that's far off thinking, that's far off dreaming. Like I'm not gonna be making comics at the rate that I was when I didn't have a kid. And there's no way, like, it's going to be made with the quality that I want, all of that. And there was a lot of negative thinking that came up. But the interesting thing was, I started reverse engineering it, seeing how it would happen, and now here I am, and I'm, like, way further on my comic than I thought I would be able to be. And it's mainly because of this working, like, 30 minutes a day on it thing. But what's interesting is like now that I'm in this mode and I'm realizing like if I keep at this pace and I'm able to keep carving out these little windows of time, it's gonna happen. Like I'm actually going to get probably about 96 pages into this and further. And so once I've hit that cap, like now I really have to start, as I'm getting closer to it, I really have to start like allowing for that success of just finishing the work. And then allowing for the thought of like, okay, so when that succeeds, where does that go? So I hope that kind of makes sense. I mean, I know it's kind of rambly, but that's just something I've been thinking about today, and it's been kind of exciting to have those thoughts again. Kind of reminds me of the feelings I got when I first started making them. So yeah, so So that's kind of my thinking today. So now I'm inking this panel, and I'm pretty happy with how it's coming out, but I'm noticing my pen is kind of being a pain in the butt. And with these inking pens, if it starts being a pain, you want to see, like, is there ink in there? And I'm noticing it is running a little dry, but there's still some ink, so I just need to kind of juice the brush a little bit to get that final ink. And I'm also excited that this panel's going pretty fast because, like I said, I really do want to, you know, maybe head out and check out, like, art panels and stuff like that for this other thing. And this is, like, art for fun kind of project that I kind of want to work on. But I also, like, it can't, like, once again, about that budgeting time thing, it can't interfere with the main project. Like, the main project has to always have momentum and always be moving forward. If the main project stalls, the main project just has a lot more possibility of never happening. But this other thing I'm really excited about, and that's more of like a family project in a weird way. And so, like, I'm kind of happy that I'm having a good momentum on this, because that means that I might be able to go to the store and do that, that little side project, which might be kind of fun. So, I don't know. I might make it kind of collaborative and see if, like, my wife, who's also an illustrator, wants to kind of help out on it, because I think it'll be kind of cool. It's like these little... The thinking behind that project that I want to try, and I'm going to tell you guys about it, but I'm not going to guarantee that there will be a YouTube video of it, because it might fail pretty epically, because I haven't painted in that style in years. But, I mean, the idea is, I love the Haunted Mansion at Disneyland. It's one of my favorite things in the universe. And one of my favorite things at the Haunted Mansion are those stretching portraits that you see when you get in the elevator on the ride. Like, there's, like, these really stretchy portraits. And even before they start stretching, I think they're just so creepy in this kind of wonderful way. That, like, one of the funny things that my wife and I used to talk about all the time when we would be talking about a potential of having a house, but we never actually had one. And at that point, it just felt like kind of just, you know, just talking for fun. One of the things I always wanted in a house was, like, well, we have, like, a dinosaur head, which is kind of rad, but... I always thought it would be cool to have, like, those creepy, like, old English manor type portraits of the family. And then I also, like, I'm a dad, so, like, I'm looking forward to the idea of, like, drawing a picture of my son. Because, like, oddly enough, all of this story that I'm working on doesn't really allow me to draw pictures of my son, because it's, like, about a time before I had kids, you know? So, So anyhow, so that's kind of the project. The idea is that I'll do this little wood panel, faux oil painted, creepy portrait of my family. And then if they come out pretty good and I come up with a method to make them and they work, then I was thinking, well, you know, maybe offer that as like a commission that I could do occasionally for people. On this YouTube channel, if they're interested in having their own, like, kind of creepy Haunted Mansion style portraits of, you know, themselves or their family. And the only catch is, like, I'm not going to offer that if they suck. So if they come out terrible, then of course I don't want to, you know, rip people off for them. But it's just a thought that I've been having today of something to do for fun. And we'll see. So we're getting a little closer to done. At this point, it's like, it's a little bit closer to there. So, I mean, like, I'll open this up to, like, you guys on watching the YouTube channel too. Like, what do you do with your own personal projects? Like, do you kind of envision a future with them? That squeaky noise you're hearing is... Benji's riding his tricycle in the house, which is pretty awesome. But Yeah, so like, I mean, what do you do to kind of like make your visions a reality? Like, do you have like a method for making things happen with your artwork? Like, I know there are friends of mine who watch these things and stuff and might be better at that than I am. So I'd be really curious to hear. Let me know in the comment section, you know? I'm also kind of like, it's funny because it's like the closer I get to finish with this, I'm noticing that my inking brush is just kind of turning out and smudging pretty uncomfortably, and I'm wondering, yeah, I'm wondering what's causing that. It's really interesting. But it is pretty funny when you're working on art and you kind of notice in your periphery like this little toddler kind of slide by on his tricycle, being helped by mom because he still hasn't quite figured out the tricycle, but he'll get there. So anyhow, I'm like, so I want to do these on board, so I'm thinking I gotta get like, you know, like wood panels to kind of possibly paint these things on, and they should probably be equal size. And then what I'll probably do is like, you know, base them on photos of my family, but you know, probably like have them in kind of old Englishy outfits, like Benji with like one of those frilly, you know, those like old outfits that you see like the Blue Boy painting and stuff with like a frilly necked shirt kind of thing. I think that would be hilarious. So we'll see. I don't know. I mean, it's kind of a, I think it's interesting, and it'll probably be good to do because another thing that kind of blows about working on a project this long is like, and it kind of doesn't because I love inking, so I don't get really bored with inking. But at the same time, you know, I haven't painted like an illustration in a long time. Like, I think the last time I painted anything was like at a event at this art store that my wife used to work at, that where they would, you know, they'd have like a live painting session, and I think that's the last time I really picked up some paints. So it's interesting because there's a part of me that's like, am I even ready to paint again? Like, it's been a long time. And then what happens if I really love painting and then I don't want to ink anymore? I'm kidding, but I mean, these are the way, this is the way my brain thinks sometimes when it comes to newer projects. Yeah. But I'm kind of excited about it as a possibility, and like I said, depending on, you know, how it works out, I'll probably like, you know, maybe make a little YouTube video, like a tutorial, like how to paint creepy family portraits. Something like that. So, let's see. We're getting there. We're getting there, YouTube. So I'm still kind of curious what you guys think about these longer extended videos. Like, do you miss the kind of shorter ones? I keep hearing this like mix from people who watch my YouTube. A lot of them are artists, and so they like kind of these longer ones because they can have them in the background while they're drawing, and it's almost like listening to a radio station or something. So like the longer they are, like the kind of like the more they like them. And then I've also heard from friends who, from people who like really feel like they want 5 or 10 minute videos that they can watch very briefly. I'm kind of mixed about it. Like, my own opinion on it with YouTube videos is like, I like the longer ones. Like, my friend Jeff Lafferty does these really like long painting videos, and I think they're now like you have to be subscribed to his Patreon to watch these longer ones, which is pretty smart because I really love his longer ones. But anyhow, so the point being, like, in the case of his videos, like, I actually prefer when they're longer. But then there are some other people who, like, when they have long videos, I'm like, oh, I don't have time to watch this whole thing. So I mean, most people I'm subscribed to, I prefer longer videos. But maybe I'm an anomaly, you know? I think from what I've heard, like, you're supposed to keep YouTube videos nice and short. But I'm kind of trying this new thing, and we'll see, like, if you guys like it or not. Where these are, pretty long, so we'll see. So now I'm kind of noticing, like, the hair has too many, it's too light of a gray now that I've blocked in some of the shade, so I'm gonna be adding a little bit, but I don't want to get too much into the hair before I've finished this shirt so I can see the overall values. But I do notice, like, I need it to go a tad bit darker because it should technically be kind of one of the darker values in the illustration. So that's what I'm working on right now. And Benji is narrating that his mom is washing, which is kind of awesome. So we'll see. You'll notice, like, there's a lot more talking and noise and stuff because I'm working during the day on this, during the afternoon. Generally, unless it's a weekend, I usually wait till night to work on projects. But I kind of wanted to knock this out in order to be able to kind of work on that painting thing that I was talking about. So we're getting a little closer to done. There's just this shoulder really to finish, and I'm hoping my brush hangs on there. I might have to get another pocket brush pen. This is why I like using the Pentel pocket brush pen, is like I could show you my backlog of these brush pens. I have like a bunch that I've just burnt the tip and just trashed. And the neat thing is, like, the cost on these is not that expensive, so you can burn through these pretty okay and not, like, break your bank, you know? And that was one of the allures of these, as well as Microns, is, like, you can just toss them and use a new one, whereas if it were, like, a Series 7, you know, it would be a whole different story, so. All right, almost there, just the shoulder. And I'm also trying not to, like, rub ink that's already wet. One of my weaknesses as an artist is I hate waiting for paint to dry. And I really dislike waiting for ink to dry as well. And sometimes that'll bite me. Like, you might notice on the last video, I smudged some of my ink. And then I had to go back over it with, like, whiteout to kind of fix the smudges. But generally, I'm pretty clean on these pages. But we'll see if I can keep clean. It's always the eternal goal of the inkers to, like, ink super clean. If you guys follow my friend Kevin Cross's channel, like, he is one of the cleanest inkers I've ever seen. He just, like, rarely will you see that guy fudge a line or smear ink. He's just incredibly got his craft down, and just a little shout out to him. But at the same time, like, I'm by no means that clean at inking. It's an interesting little battle. I've also noticed, like, artists using those little finger glove things that help prevent smudging. And I've been using this, like, you know, recycled paper thing for a long time, where I just fold a little piece of paper, and that keeps my hand from smudging my inks, but I'm wondering if that's more effective, the little finger glove thing. So I'm gonna have to ask about that because I've never actually used those. If you guys use them, let me know. Do you like the finger glove thing? All right. So we're almost finished. So at this point, I'm gonna say, you know, thanks to those of you who like and comment and share and subscribe to my YouTube videos. It just it helps this, you know, channel kind of build more of a community, And it also helps me stay encouraged and interested in like making these videos, and also gives me a little kick to like keep producing content, making pages, because you know I know there are people watching. And so thanks especially to those of you who've subscribed. It means a lot and it helps a lot. So if you haven't yet, and you've been watching, you know, more than one of these videos, you know, subscribing is just a really cool thing to do. It's a free thing to do. It doesn't cost you anything. And when you subscribe, it'll let you know when there are updates, so that you don't even have to like check back on YouTube all the time. So like, you know, oh, what's going on? Like, it'll be in your little subscription feed, marked as like a little red dot when, you know, when you're subscribed, and can send you notifications and stuff. So it's a good way to kind of keep in tune with like when this channel updates and stuff. And if you absolutely hate these long format, you know, ones, please speak up, because otherwise I'm gonna keep making them. And you know, and like the one way I'd know, if you guys are preferring the long format or, you know, like the short format, is if you tell me. So just let me know. Just give me a heads up in the comments section. Okay, so I finished panel 2 of page 48. I almost said 38 of Quarterly Stories. So that will do it for this vlog. And I might try to ink panel 3, but we'll see. And if so, that'll probably be a different vlog. And I will see you guys next week. Thank you.